Welcome to Horse Talk Live. Enjoy the next hour learning more about the people, places, and products of the horse industry. And now, Horse Talk Live on Rural TV.
Hey, everybody, and welcome to Horse Talk Live on Rural TV. I'm equine correspondent and your host for the program, Lizzie Iwersen. As always, during today's show, you're welcome to call in with any questions that you have. Our phone number is 877-731-6733, or at any time before or after the show, you can write me an email at horses@rfdtv.com. We'll be taking questions about training, about horse health, questions, comments, suggestions, anything you want, we'll take it at horses@rfdtv.com. Well, if my guest today looks familiar, he is has been on Horse Talk Live before. He is Dr. Monty McInturff from Tennessee Equine Hospital in Middle Tennessee. It's Thompson Station, Tennessee. So, Dr. McInturff, welcome to the show once again today.
Thank you, Lizzie. It's great to be back.
Well, it's nice to have a relationship with you, not only business-wise here on Horse Talk Live, but personally. You and I have gotten to know each other well over the last couple of weeks.
We have, for most definitely.
And just really want to welcome you back here and want to let folks know that if you do have any questions have anything to do with veterinarian issues, you can send me those questions and I'll pass them on to Dr. McInturff, and he has graciously offered to answer those questions, and we'll get to your question live on Horse Talk Live. So feel free to send those questions. Take advantage of this opportunity from Dr. McInturff. Well, since I've seen you last, what have you been up to?
It's been busy. It's springtime. I mean, the horses are, the show season's coming up. The babies are being born. I mean, it's a really busy time. We've had great weather here in Tennessee.
Yes.
So we've really been enjoying that as horse folks. So we've been taking care of lots of patients and doing a lot of wellness exams and performance horse exams.
Well, you mentioned it, performance horse exams. Today's show, we're kind of going to be focusing on the diagnosis and treatment of performance horse lameness. And unfortunately, I have a horse that's near and dear to me who has come up lame, and he is indeed a performance horse. He's quick. Everybody's met him before. He has become a Horse Talk Live regular. Unfortunately, today he's going to be focusing, we're focusing on an issue that he's had that I couldn't take care of myself. I had to, thankfully, I have Dr. McInturff to rely on to help me with this, and this is something that you deal with regularly too, these performance horses and injuries they sustain because they're out and about doing things that is a little bit different than grazing in the pasture.
Exactly. You know, horses are athletes, and we ask them to do very athletic things. And I hate to say it, but they're going to have injuries. They're going to run into problems. And your veterinarian is there to help you with those problems. It's so important for you to have a relationship with your vet. And I'm proud to be your vet.
Well, it's worked out well. I mean, it's been a tough situation. It's not ideal having a horse that isn't performing at his peak right now. But like we said before, it's something that everybody who has a performance horse is going to have to deal with. And so on today's show, we hope that we're going to be able to shed some light on what to do if your horse comes up lame. And Quick has a specific injury, but some of the things that we're going to discuss today kind of bleed over into other injuries that your horse may happen to have, and some routine procedures that we go through for a lameness exam. You know, I notice what I do with Quick is barrel racing and team roping primarily. We do a lot of other things, but I have some photos from the past of Quick and I, and you can see he's been my A-team head horse for a while, and I heel on him also. So we travel around Tennessee and other places. Also, he's one heck of a barrel horse, and he really tries hard and would never let me know if he was hurting in any way, you know, by not wanting to go in the gate or anything like that. But when I was at Road to the Horse, I used him all day. And then at the end of the day, I had a lesson with Aaron Ralston. And that's when I started noticing that something wasn't quite right. I've had Quick for about 3.5 years now. I've never seen him take a lame step. And so it was pretty scary for me when we started working, and I could feel something was off. And then I asked Aaron afterwards, I'm like, did you see anything? And so, you know, he was like, yeah, he was just off. And after that full day of riding, you know, that's what we kind of, when we noticed it. So I went to Dr. McInturff and I told him the problem. And so then he said, bring him in. We got to do a lameness exam, and we'll get to the root of the problem and figure out, we'll diagnose it, and then we'll figure out a treatment plan. So that's what we did, and that's what we're going to be talking about today. We have some great video that Dr. McInturff has provided for us. But let's talk about why horses come up lame in the first place.
Well, you know, just from that video, I could see he was definitely a little short, and he looked to be a little off right front to me. And you're like, you know, he's always been sound. And I hear that a lot. I mean, mm-hmm. you know your horse better than anybody. And I hear that a lot, but there's going to be days that he's going to be a little sore. And I could see from that video that he was coming up a little short. So when you're at a competition, the things you need to look out for is, hey, have I warmed up my horse properly? Am I riding my horse too long? Okay. Are his feet properly balanced? If the feet are too long or too short, that can be an issue. You know, what's the footing? You know, where I'm at, what's the footing like? We know in some of these arenas it's a little deep or maybe a little hard. So there's lots of little things we can look for to help maybe prevent this. But in reality, it's no one's fault. That horse wants to work for you, but he just had a day where he was showing some lameness. And I'm excited to show the audience what we did to figure out what's wrong with Quick. And we definitely have come up with a diagnosis, mm-hmm. and that's what we're planning to share in the rest of the show.
And how important is it, you know, you asked me Quick's background, but that's definitely something you have to take into consideration before you even get started on the exam.
Oh, most definitely. I want to know exactly what his job is. I want to know how old he is. I want to know, you know, what is he eating? I want to know what type of support bandaging or boots you're wearing on him.
Okay.
I want to know how he shod. I want to know all these little background things because they may give me clues. And I want to, like I said, I want to know exactly what he does for a job. Is he a head horse? Is he a heel horse? Does he run the barrels? Do you jump him? I mean, what exactly does he do? Because that'll give me a clue as to what's going on.
Do you find that that gives you like an idea of where to really start looking at the very get-go?
Oh, most definitely. I mean, on head horses, I know that right front leg takes a lot of pressure. Because we're roping that steer and we're turning right. On the barrel horses, I know how many left turns and how many right turns.
Okay.
I mean, I know exactly about if you're jumping, how you're pushing off the back end. So based on his job, it gives me some clues to what might be going on. I see a lot of lame horses, so I get an idea of what's common.
And in the performance horse, I mean, these horses are obviously doing their job, so that's where you see it when horses are out doing jobs. Versus in the pasture.
Oh, most definitely. You know, there's different degrees of lameness. A grade 5 lameness is non-weight bearing. He's holding the leg up. I don't want to walk on it. That's obvious. Anybody can diagnose that.
Okay.
A grade 1 lameness is very subtle. Maybe only when the horse is going in one direction. Maybe when the horse is only going at a certain gait. That's a real subtle lameness. And some people can't see that, but the rider can always feel it. You know, he's not willing to turn to the left like he always does. So I'm looking for those little clues of how's he bending his neck, how's he turning. Those are little clues.
What about on Quick's, in Quick's case, some days, like, I don't know exactly when this happened, but like I said, I noticed it after a long day. So it was kind of intermittent, like he, you know, I unfortunately work so much that some days some weeks he'd have off. And then I'd come back and he'd be fine.
Right.
And then, you know, for a while he was just fine. And then this one day where I used him all day.
Right.
That's when I saw it.
Well, you know, what you're declaring there is kind of a chronic type issue. An acute issue is, hey, he's fine today. He's off tomorrow. What you just said to me is he's had a little something nagging him for a while.
Okay.
And a little bit of rest cleans it up. And then it starts nagging him again, right? So usually I see that kind of situation with soft tissue injuries.
Okay.
That's the first thing that pops into my head is maybe he's got a soft tissue injury. Soft tissue would be like a tendon or ligament type injury.
Okay. Well, before we get to a break, we actually have a phone call.
Oh, great.
So we'll kind of switch directions for a minute. So we'll go to that phone call. And what's your question for Dr. Monty? Jeanette?
Yes.
Go ahead with your question.
I have a horse that's, he's a little over 25 years old. He's lost some weight. And last year I was able to put it back on him with some beet pulp. And is there a way to put it back on him a little bit faster? I feed him sweet feed twice a day. we no longer work, and he's a quarter horse. He used to do a lot of barrel racing and stuff, but now he has a life of leisure. So.
Okay, good question.
Yeah, Jeanette, thank you for that question. You know, we see that a lot in some older horses as their body starts to change. It's really, really important that you get his teeth checked to make sure his dental, get a good dental exam and have his teeth floated if that needs to be. Make sure he's on a good deworming program. And if those are both covered, the thing I like the most for these older horses is I love rice bran. Rice bran is a very effective, high in fat way of putting calories into a diet. And there are some special feeds formulated just for older horses that are more easily digested. So you may want to look into what you're feeding and make sure it's perfect for the older horse.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks, Jeanette, for calling in with that question. We want to remind you at home that Dr. Monty is here to answer your questions on today's program. So feel free to give us a call at 877-731-6733. We're here to answer those questions. We are going to take a short break and come back and learn a little bit more about what's going on with Quick and what is causing him to be sore in his legs here. Find out what the problem is and find out how we're going to get him back on the road to recovery so I can head back out on that rodeo trail. Stick around with more on Horse Talk Live. We'll be back. All right, welcome back to Horse Talk Live on Rural TV. I'm Lizzie Iwersen, and my guest today is Dr. Monty McInturff of Tennessee Equine Hospital in Thompson Station, Tennessee. He has agreed to be back on Horse Talk Live with us. He's been here before. We did some general horse information and horse care, health care. And today, we are talking about my horse in particular. We are talking about Quick, who we've all seen here before on Horse Talk Live. Somebody that, a horse who is near and dear to me. And we're talking about the diagnosis and treatment of performance horse lameness because Quick himself has come up lame. So that's what we're going to be detailing today, but we've also invited our viewers to call in with questions, and we do have a phone call right now, and we're going to get to that question. So Nancy from Missouri, what's your question for Dr. Monty?
Okay, my horse has had the slobbers for 2 months now. I've taken him to the local vet. I've had her teeth floated. We changed the hay, but she's still just drooling really horribly. And I'm wondering if there's something else that I can do.
She's from Missouri.
Well, Nancy, thanks for calling in. And you know, this time of year, we see a lot of horses slobbering. And the number one cause in Tennessee, Tennessee is what I can tell you about, is clover. Clover has a toxin in it that causes the horse to drool a lot. And the toxin lives in the root. And you see it mostly in the afternoon as the sap rises from the root into the leaves. That's when the clover has the most toxin that causes the slobbering. It's just unsightly. It's not a medical condition.
Okay.
It's not something to worry about. It's just something that's a little unsightly. So if you're going to stop in Tennessee, if you want to stop slobbering, you got to get the horses off the clover. Check your pasture. I bet you got clover in it.
But it's no reason to worry is what you're saying.
It's not a reason to worry, but it is a little unsightly.
It is. I've seen it myself, and it's no joke.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'll pull my horse's mouth down, and it'll just...
It's the clover.
We don't have it up in Montana. It's definitely something that is regional. So very interesting. Thank you for that phone call. Well, let's get back to Quick and what we're going to talk about. You know, I called you, and I told you what the problem was.
Right.
I had noticed this lameness, and... Quick is 14 years old. He's a performance horse. I use him a lot.
Right.
So inevitably things are going to happen. Like I said, I've never seen him take a lame step, but it's something that unfortunately we have to deal with.
You know, watching the little video, I could see which leg he was lame in, but I hate to say from that video what's wrong with him. So I need to do an examination. I had you bring him into the hospital. My team and I worked him up. And we went through some steps. The first thing we're going to do is get a good history from you, which you shared with us.
Mm-hmm.
The next thing we're going to do is we're going to put our hands all over him.
Okay.
We're going to check his neck. We're going to check his back. We're going to check his hips. We're going to palpate his legs. Then we're going to take out some hoof testers. We're going to examine his feet. 80% of all lameness is in the foot. I'd say 8 out of 10 lamenesses I see has a foot issue. So it's very important to do a good examination of the foot.
Okay.
After we do that, we're going to take him outside. We're going to watch him go, watch him in a round pen, soft ground, hard ground. After we do that, we're going to be taking notes as we go through this process, right? Looking for soreness, looking for pain. Then we're going to do a flexion exam. That's where we hold the joint in flexion.
Okay.
And we jog the horse off and we see how he responds to that flexion. Much like you and I kneeling down and for like 60 seconds and trying to jump up and run off. Me, I'm a little slow getting up, right? I'm a little older. You probably jump up and run off. So if I have a little arthritis in my knees, it's harder for me to get up. And
that's
and
what you're looking for in the flexion
I'm
test.
Looking for arthritis.
Okay.
I'm looking for arthritis in the joints. So we go through this process to determine where is the area that Quick hurts. That's what we're looking for. And I think we've got a video here of Quick's exam, if we could show that.
And this is a pretty routine exam. This is something that you do.
It's a standard exam. Yep.
Okay. Well, let's look at that video. There we go. This is the beautiful hospital here.
Yeah, here we have Quick coming into the hospital. This is Tennessee Equine Hospital here in Thompson Station, Tennessee. Quick looks pretty relaxed. We've got a couple of technicians taking him in. Not sure how. Here we are doing a hoof tester exam. I mentioned that to you. What I'm doing here is I'm pinching on the feet with these hoof testers looking for soreness. A lot of lameness occurs in the foot. So a hoof tester exam will give you a tremendous amount of information. I'm checking the sole. I'm checking the wall. Here I'm adjusting my hoof testers. I'm checking the frog. See how I'm pinching on the frog? I'm looking for a response. That's a pretty normal response there. He gave me just a little flinch there on the inside. I'd give that a 1. Here I'm checking across the heels. I'm looking for areas of pain. Now, I did this exam on all 4 feet.
Okay.
I checked all 4 feet out. Now, after we did that exam, I took him outside and I'm watching him go, okay? I've got him in a round pen on hard footing. And I've got my assistant is having him. We did the walk first. Now we're doing the trot, and now we're doing the lope. See, we're loping, making sure he's on the proper lead, right?
And the ground there, like you said, it's not deep ground, so that you can see everything that's
right.
going on.
Right, harder ground is easier to see lameness on. Typically, however, we have a sand ring as well. That some lameness shows up in sand.
Oh, okay.
We're watching to the left, right? Now we're watching to the right. I'm looking to see how he's carrying his head. Is he carrying his head out of the circle, or is he folding his head in? Notice there, he's kind of carrying his head turned out of the circle a little bit. See that? A horse that's comfortable is going to carry his head centered very nicely.
Okay.
I'm also watching how he's tracking up there, how his back legs are pushing off. So I'm taking notes, right? I'm watching and looking for little weaknesses.
All parts that make up the whole puzzle here.
Exactly. We got to know the whole horse. So I want to watch him walk, trot, and canter, or walk, trot, lope in both directions. So now we're asking him to lope off to the right and see if he picks his leads up. So I'm taking notes here, and I'm watching very closely. So this lameness today, watching him go on the round pen, I would give him like a 1+. Now here I'm palpating his legs. See, I just palpated the left front. I noticed him take a couple of uneven steps on the right front. Notice here I'm doing a suspensory exam. I'm palpating his suspensory. I'm just doing gentle pressure on the suspensory. Now watch him respond. See how he's leaning back?
Yep.
Ouch. See that?
Yeah.
See that right there? I noticed when the right front leg was on the outside of the circle, he took a couple of bad steps.
Okay.
So it made me look at his suspensory. Here I'm doing a flexion exam, okay? I'm holding the knee relaxed, and I'm flexing the fetlock, pastern, and coffin all at the same time. I'm going to hold it with firm pressure for 60 seconds. I'm going to release the leg, and we're going to trot him off, okay? Let's see how he responds to that right front flexion. Let's watch him. See there? See him nod his head?
Yeah.
He didn't like that.
No.
Yeah, he didn't like that. See him turning there? See how he's kind of dropping his head a little bit? So that was a positive flexion. That was a 3 out of 5. All veterinarians grade their flexions. So here I'm also checking the back legs. We're doing an examination on the rear legs. This is a upper limb flexion, left rear. I'm flexing the hock and the stifle. See, I'm holding it in a flex position for 60. Now I'm going to release it. Let's watch him go off there. He's a little short on it there. I've seen that's a positive flexion.
Okay.
And
what you do to one side, you do to the other.
Exactly. You always do the same side. Now this is the right hind. We're showing the right hind upper limb flexion. Now let's watch him go here. You see him dragging that leg a little bit?
Yep.
See, that definitely bothers him there. That's a solid 3 out of 5.
So from what we saw there, what were your first thoughts?
Well, I noticed a right fore lameness when he was in the round pen, okay? And I noticed him leaning a little short behind. So from that exam, I knew that something was going on in the right front fetlock.
Okay.
And I felt like something was going on in both hocks, right hock being worse than the left.
Okay.
So what I would say from that is a lot of lameness in performance horses you'll see it in multiple legs, right? It just won't be in one leg.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to determine which is the worst and how bad is it.
Well, I'm just going to brag on your facility and your people really quick, because what is so nice about being able to go to your vet clinic is that you had that round pen there for to do like such a thorough exam and have good help. I showed up at 9:30 at night, and a gal came down that was staying there and put Quick to bed, and everybody was so nice. So it really helps to know your vet and to have a facility like yours that enables you to do the most thorough of exams and make sure that what is wrong is something that you can diagnose easily.
Well, I really appreciate you saying that. And we do have a nice facility, but we have it for the horse. That's why we have it, so that we can give you good information about the horse. And there's great hospitals all over this nation. And I encourage you to not be afraid to take your horse to your vet, because they'll help you.
You bet. Okay, so we did the initial exam there, and you kind of figured out what you thought was wrong. When you palpated him and he flinched like that, where was it that he was showing lameness?
Right. So what I did is there's in the back of the leg there, you have tendons and you have ligaments. So I gently palpated his tendons and ligaments.
Okay.
And where he was showing me pain was right in the middle of his suspensory. The suspensory attaches to the back of the knee, and okay. It goes down, and about mid-canon, it branches. And just before it branches, Quick's suspensory was really sore. He didn't want me to touch it.
Right.
Yeah. And honestly, when I saw the video of you riding that day with the instructor, I could see that he had a right fore lameness going to the left. Suspensory pain usually shows more when the leg is to the outside of the circle.
Is that suspensory straight down the, like if the, in the back of the leg, or is it, where is it
right
positioned?
Dead in the center, right in okay. The back of the leg. So we have the cannon bone, and we have the little splint bones, mm-hmm. And the suspensory lays right in the back of the cannon bone, and its job is to hold up the fetlock. It's like the shock absorbers of the horse. Like we have shocks on our car, right? So we have lots of bumps, and our car bounces. Bad shocks, what happens? We bounces too hard. In the horse, a suspensory that's weak is going to bounce you too much, right? So these suspensories have to be firm to hold that ankle up. So that's what the suspensory is.
Okay. So it's pretty dang important.
Really important. Really important.
Okay. What else could you say about Quick's? You know, we noticed that arthritis too.
Right.
But is this the, what's the worst thing that he has going on here?
Right. Well, you know, the suspensory, I feel like the suspensory is where his acute pain is. I mean, that's the most important thing that I've seen there. And that something's going on in that fetlock. And I really wanted to take some nice set of x-rays for you, right? And I also want to ultrasound that suspensory to find out how bad it is. And I think we're going to look at that here in our next section.
Mm-hmm.
But I will throw out to you that I think the suspensory is the acute thing. I think his hocks have been going on a while, and he's been dealing with it. Because you yourself said, hey, look, Quick loves to work, right? And with joint pain, the more they warm up, the better they get, right? So
okay. They'll
warm out of it. And so he looked a little stiff behind to me because he came right out of a trailer, and
mm-hmm.
I did my exam. A lot of times with hock pain, they'll warm up. But with suspensory pain, they'll get worse as they go.
So how do you think Quick could have done this? And what is there anything that I could have done to prevent a suspensory injury?
Well, I can tell you that in heading horses, the right front leg takes a lot of pressure. So good boots to support the fetlock.
Okay.
I know there's lots of boots on the market, right?
Yeah.
So good support boots to support that. Also, after you work hard, something that I love is ice,
okay. Right?
Yeah. Ice boots or ice wraps to protect your horse after work. So those are things you might want to consider.
Okay. Well, I think we have another phone call, so we're going to switch directions, quit talking about Quick for a little bit, and answer a question that we have from a viewer.
Great.
Ken from Arizona, what's your question for us?
I got a horse that goes up to the gate and sucks on, or puts his teeth on the gate and pulls back, or maybe like sucking wind or cribber or whatever you call it, and then he'll go walk off and come back and do it again, then go eat and come back again.
Right.
Okay.
Well, You know, Ken, thanks for calling in. That's a bad habit. That sounds like cribbing or windsucking. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's some endorphins released in the brain when horses do that type movement, when they suck air, and they kind of get high from it. And it's something that horses like to do once they start doing it, and it's not a good thing. You might want to talk to your veterinarian about some medication to help. There is some medication available to help decrease the desire to want to crib or windsuck.
Really?
Yep. And also, there's a surgery where you can go in and clip some of the nerves in the neck to help prevent that from occurring. But it's a learned response, and once they learn it, they kind of get a little euphoric from it. So I encourage you to, you may want to even consider getting a muzzle, right? A little muzzle. Oh, okay. So that he can't get his teeth on things. But once they start that, Ken, it's tough to get them stopped.
But it's not necessarily hurting the horse or anything?
Well,
it's
not.
Is they going
to have any... You know, sometimes they can suck too much air in and get a little gas colic.
Interesting.
But if you notice horses that crib or windsuck, they're usually horses that are a little bit skinny, because they'd rather crib than eat.
It is so weird. Like, it's an addiction.
Yeah, it's an addiction.
It's so weird.
It's silly. Yeah. But that's just kind of how they are. Huh. People are like that sometimes. They kind of get off on things they shouldn't be getting into.
All right. Well, we are going to continue our talk about Quick and his lameness issue. We're going to look at some more video and see what goes into a lameness exam. If your horse comes up lame and you need to take him to the vet, this is what you can expect. Our guest today is Dr. Monty McInturff. So call in with any questions that you have about lameness or any veterinarian questions in general. Our number is 877-731-6733. Stick around. We'll be back with more on Horse Talk Live. Jeepers. Welcome back to Horse Talk Live on Rural TV. I'm Lizzie Iwersen, and we're talking about horse health today. Our special client of the day happens to be my horse, Quick, who has come up lame, and I've enlisted the help of my vet, Dr. Monty McInturff, who is your vet for today as well. We've asked you to call in with any questions that you have for some advice from Dr. McInturff. He has taken Quick into his clinic and done a thorough exam on him. And so what we're learning about today is the whole diagnosis process and then how we're going to treat it and help Quick get on the road to recovery. Right now, we're going to take a phone call and ask Dr. Monty. We have Kelly from Idaho. Hi, Kelly. What's your question?
Doctor, how important are protective boots? Could Quick's problem be adverted if his boots were tighter or a different type?
That's a good question.
Please repeat that.
The protective boots, his sports medicine boots.
How important are
lack of?
Yeah. Oh, most definitely. I mean, having good support, too tight is a problem. You're exactly right. You can cause some injury to the tendon and ligaments around the fetlock and in the cannon bone area with too tight of bandaging. So you're most definitely correct. Not having them at all can be a problem. So most definitely, having them too tight or not having boots or support or wraps is key for athletes.
Because they support both the fetlock and some movement there, but also like hitting or, you know, some surface damage too, right?
Most definitely. I mean, concussion, interfering,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
you know, so
exactly.
You want to protect from it. There's splint boots that protect from interfering. There's support boots that support, for a lot of your support boots, what they're doing is they're helping to hold up the fetlock. So that when you're working, the fetlock doesn't drop too much. The more the fetlock drops, the more the pull on the suspensory.
Okay, which is exactly what we're talking about.
And we're talking about that today. So that's a great question, Kelly. You can put boots on wrong, right?
Okay.
So make sure that they fit properly.
Okay. And so what you have done so far with Quick was watch him work.
Right.
And then you put your hands on him and palpated, and you noticed, you located that spot.
Right, some soreness, correct.
And so that gives you an idea of where to go now. And
yeah.
So what is your next step at that point?
Yeah, first thing we got to do, like we say, is we want to isolate where the pain is. And so I feel like the pain is in the right front fetlock area and in the right and left hock. So the first thing we want to do is we want to take some radiographs. You know, I could have just said, hey, Lizzie, I found some pain here. Here's some medicine, rest him for a week, let's see what happens. But I know you, right? You're going to want more answers than just, hey, he's got some pain here. So I need x-rays to look at the bones, right?
Because had I gone on with it, the problem is not going to fix itself.
Well,
it's just going to...
You know, there's a difference between soreness and injury.
Okay.
That could have just been soreness. I could have just given you some medication and said, hey, look, do this, try him again in a week. And if he was better, great. If he's not better, you're going to be, well, you know, I need to know what's wrong. So while he was there, I'm trying to help you to know what's wrong.
Okay.
So I have other tools, right?
Mm-hmm.
I have digital x-ray that's going to look at the bones. I have digital ultrasound that's going to help to look at the tendons and ligaments of that area. We also at Tennessee Equine Hospital have access to an MRI. An MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, will look at the bones and the soft tissue all at once. So it's probably the gold standard for diagnostics.
Sure.
So I'll just mention that to you to say, hey, look, these are tools that we have available.
Right.
But I think we have a video where mm-hmm. we can show the audience what we did to find out exactly what was wrong with Quick.
Okay, well, let's look at that and see what the next step would be on this lameness exam.
Well, here you'll see we're taking some digital radiographs. I've got my technician holding a Canon digital plate. We're wearing lead aprons to protect ourselves, but I'm shooting different angles of the fetlock, and it's so important. If you get an x-ray, you can't just take one angle. You need to look at all the different angles. So you'll notice here we're going around that right front fetlock, and I'm taking a nice set. The reason I'm focusing on the fetlock, remember, when I flexed him, it hurt, right?
Yeah.
So I knew to go to that area and look because he was very painful on flexion. And we're also taking some radiographs of his hocks, right? Because on flexion, I found that he was very painful on flexion of his hocks. And the hock in the horse, especially the western horse or the jumping horse, hocks are critical. Keeping hocks comfortable is critical. Because if those hocks aren't comfortable, he may overload his front end and cause extra stress.
Okay.
And I don't know that that's what happened with Quick, but it could have.
Sure.
So here we've taken our x-rays, and now I'm reviewing the x-rays. Here's a couple of images of fetlocks. There's a front-to-back view on the left and a lateral view on the right, and I'm looking at the bones in relation to each other. Now you're seeing a digital ultrasound. After I took my x-rays, right, I determined that the x-rays of his fetlock were clean.
Okay.
I didn't find anything on the x-ray, so now I'm using the ultrasound, and I'm focusing my ultrasound on that area where I found the pain.
And this is a soft tissue.
Soft tissue, correct. I'm looking at the back of his canon, which looks at the tendons and the ligaments, right? And I'm starting at the back of the knee, and I'm working my probe down the leg, and I'm looking at all the different levels. And I look in two planes. I look in a cross-sectional plane and a longitudinal plane. What that's gonna tell me is, are the fibers of that suspensory normal?
Okay. And you can do that instantly. It's right in front of you.
Exactly.
Pretty,
and so here I'm showing my technician. I'm showing my technician some swelling in the suspensory.
Okay.
Right there in the center of the screen. I'm getting ready to take some measurements here. Right in the center of the screen, you can see the suspensory ligament. And the suspensory ligament should be a certain size. So I'm measuring the suspensory ligament right now to determine the size. And if you look right in the center, that little black area, that swelling in Quick suspensory.
Okay.
He has a suspensory desmitis, an inflamed, swollen suspensory. See that? See the swelling right there in the center? Here's a longitudinal picture on the left that shows it up and down, and on the right it shows a cross-section. And you can see that black area in the center of the suspensory. So what does that mean? That means he strained his suspensory.
Okay. And then...
And here I'm showing Lizzie our findings. There on the left, I've got a normal suspensory, and there on the right, I've got an abnormal suspensory. So I'm showing the different suspensories to help her understand exactly what's going on. So Quick strained his suspensory. Sorry, Lizzie,
but
that's what happened.
Well, you know, it could be worse.
Yeah.
It wasn't a tear. So what is the difference between the strain that we saw and if had it been worse, had it been a tear, what would,
right,
what's the difference?
A tear will typically present much lamer.
Okay.
You notice he was off, but he wasn't just head bobbing lame until I stretched him. And also on ultrasound, I'm going to see a much blacker or darker hole than just a kind of a little bit of hypoechoic, just kind of lightly grayish hole. So from my exam, I could tell it's not torn. There may be a little micro tearing, but most of it's just swelling. So I'm thinking he worked too hard that day, right?
Yeah.
The day that you had him at the road to the horse, you were on him all day. You said that,
yeah,
right? And it established some swelling there.
And the swelling is exactly right where you touched him. It was just like a,
exactly,
bruise right there. Just if you were to pinch yourself where you were already hurt, like it.
Right. And when you're doing a suspensory exam on your own horse, if you want to palpate the suspensory, I can pinch a horse hard enough to make him flinch, okay? But I don't want to do that, right? I just want to put gentle pressure on him. And if you put gentle pressure on a sore spot, he's going to say, no, don't do that, right?
Yeah.
So I picked up on that early in the exam, and and the ultrasound confirmed it.
Yeah, and when you showed that to me, you showed me how much pressure to put on there, and it was
it's pretty obvious.
Was uncomfortable. And going through the x-rays and the radiographs instantly, that was great, like being able to see right away, you know,
right,
what you're looking at. And what we're going to do later is, because we have the pictures from last week, then we can look later and compare the two.
Most definitely. And your veterinarian is going to have access to quality x-rays. And, you know, radiographs have come a long way over the years. Used to, we would take a picture, we would have to go in the dark room, develop it. Now there's digital radiographs, right? They're instantaneous for us to look at. Yeah, it's nice, yeah. And I can take those x-rays and I could send them to a veterinarian somewhere else, right? If you wanted a second opinion, mm-hmm, I could email those to another veterinarian. And so we can, as veterinarians, we can communicate a lot better than we used to could. So having that information and all that information is archived there at the hospital. So when you come back, we can do comparisons.
Always keep an eye on how things are going, which is something else that is not Quick's main problem right now, but we're going to be able to see the changes in his hocks throughout, because they,
right,
are changing right now is what we found.
Right.
Out.
We didn't talk a lot about that, but I did find some arthritis in his hocks. And in the hock, you have four joints, right? One joint moves. And the other three joints, they're compression joints. They just barely squeeze together. Well, I found some arthritis in his hocks. And I think he's been dealing with that because he's a tough guy. But he's 14 now, right?
Yeah.
So we're going to talk about how we can help his hocks. But the first thing we got to do is get that suspensory well.
Mm-hmm.
And until it's well, we don't need to be riding Quick.
I know, which... tear for Lizzie. But I'm learning how to be patient and learning that taking care of him is the most important thing right now to make sure that those fibers can heal correctly.
Correct.
There are some, you know, fancy procedures we can do, but right now we're just going to take it slow, and we're going to talk more about that and what it's going to take to get Quick well. We have a phone call right now, and
great,
someone who wants a little bit of advice from Dr. Monty.
Awesome.
Go ahead with your phone call. Polly from Arizona. Are you there?
Hi, Polly.
Yeah.
What's your question for Dr. Monty?
I have a 7-year-old quarter horse that was diagnosed with a navicular.
Right.
And they tried, like, the egg bar shoes on him and everything, and he won't keep them on. He can't be rode. He's always coming up lame. They recommended nerve deadening.
Right.
I was just wondering what your opinion is on that.
Well, yeah,
Yeah. Or, you know, if it's more problems down the road for him.
Right, right. Well, thanks for that question, Holly. You know, navicular disease is a terrible disease. And the navicular bone's a little bone that sits right in the back of the foot. And it acts like a little pulley for the deep flexor tendon to go across. So the navicular bone takes a lot of pressure. And if you have a horse with navicular pain as a 7-year-old, that's pretty early, okay? So, yeah, you know, recommending nerving as a 7-year-old, you know, if I recommended that to you, it would kind of be a last-ditch effort for me.
Okay.
There are things that we can do beyond shoeing, like navicular bursal injections, which can get medicine right to the navicular bone. There's other medications that are available to help stimulate the circulation to the navicular bone. I encourage you to talk to your veterinarian about medications to improve the circulation to the bone and to decrease the inflammation. Shoeing's a big part of it, but that's not the only thing. If you do all the things I mentioned, bursal injections, medication, and shoeing, and you still have a horse that's very uncomfortable, the nerving is fine to do, okay? And we do that procedure ourselves, but it's the last ditch effort. Those nerves will grow back. And I tell folks that you're looking at about a year and a half to 2 years of comfort before those nerves will regenerate. Yes. So it's not like a permanent fix. And there's other things you have to be concerned about, like hoof abscess, because they can't feel their feet anymore. But there's a lot of nice horses that have had a nerve procedure, and it's not a bad thing. Okay. So I'm not trying to talk you out of it. I'm just a little concerned about a seven-year-old, a young horse having a procedure like that. But thanks for calling.
Okay, that's a great question and something, unfortunately, just like what we're going through here, if you have a horse, you have to go through some of these things.
Yeah.
You know, it's inevitable, but that's what our veterinarians are for. That's what Dr. Monty McInturff is here for. He's here to answer your questions and talk about what it is that's going on with my own personal horse and trying to help me figure it out and get him better so I can hit the trail again. Stick around. Give us a phone call, 877-731-6733. We'll be back with more on Horse Talk Live. Hi, and welcome back to Horse Talk Live on Rural TV. I'm Lizzie Iwersen, and today we are talking about some horse health, some maintenance, and in performance horses in particular. One performance horse that we're talking about is my little buddy, Quick. He is the horse that I head and heel and run barrels off of. We chase cows, we trail ride, we do everything. So it's important for me to make sure that he is in good working order. And a few weeks ago, he was not, and so I called up Monty McInturff, my veterinarian, who is also your veterinarian today. You can call in with any questions that you have for him. And he recommended that I bring him into the clinic and did a full diagnostic exam on him, something that he does regularly with performance horses and sees it all the time. You know, lameness is something that all of us horse owners have to deal with, unfortunately, but those four legs are mighty important underneath our horses, so we've got to make sure that they're kept sound. Like I said, we've invited you to call in with any questions that you have, and we do have a caller on the line. We have Joan from South Dakota who has a question for Dr. Monty. Now go ahead with your question, Joan.
Dr. Monty, I have a 20-year-old mare that is 7 weeks from foaling. She has an old injury and a tendon injury in the left front. I've been putting a Zorbine on it and wondered if maybe boots would be helping her. I have wrapped it. Seems to give her a little relief, but I just want her to be comfortable and not use too much to, you know, harm the baby before it arrives.
Okay, thanks, Joan.
Well, thanks for calling in, Joan. You know, late-term pregnancy is a lot of stress on a horse's legs. So, I mean, the weight of the horse, they put on a lot of weight those last 2 months. So if you have an old injury, which you've shared with us, it's very, very important that you support it, because the big stress is going to be when she gets up and down, right? When she gets up and down with that extra weight, it's going to put a lot of stress on her tendons and ligaments. So, I mean, I like alcohol, okay? Just straight alcohol is very cooling and soothing. I also like ice. If you think it's bothering her, get you an ice boot, and about 20 minutes a day, let her wear that ice boot and interchange that with some support bandaging. You know, if it's really, really hurting her, I would talk to your veterinarian about some medication to help her deal with that, because we don't want her to be stressed, because stress will affect the baby. And we want that baby to stay in there as long as it needs to, right? So it's a healthy baby. But thanks for calling.
Yeah, that's a good question. That's very important.
That's awesome.
Make sure she's comfortable.
Yeah, very important.
I think any woman could testify to that.
Sure.
Okay, well, let's talk about, we've figured out the problem with my horse, Quick.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't good news, but it wasn't too terrible.
Right.
What is it that I have to do now to take care to make sure he is going to heal correctly?
Right. Well, here's the bad news, okay? Quick needs some time off. Anytime you're dealing with a soft tissue injury, if you medicate that and you continue to work, you're potentially going to injure it further, right? So with a suspensory injury, the last thing you want to do is to medicate the horse and go to the next rodeo, right?
Yeah.
So we don't want to do that. I've asked you and Quick to give 30 days, right?
Yeah.
30 days, stall rest, hand walking, okay? During that time, we're going to try to get the swelling down in that suspensory. and I'm going to talk to you about adjusting the feet. I encourage you to go ahead and pull the shoes.
Yeah.
While the horse is up, let's go ahead and pull his shoes. He doesn't have to have his shoes on while he's up. And let's go ahead and lower his heel just a little bit and let his toe be just a little bit longer. Why don't we do that? Because we're tightening the tendons, okay, which is relaxing the suspensory.
Okay.
So Quick's going to rest for 30 days.
And keeping him in that stall is preventing him from going, catching some free spirit action in
right,
the field.
Right, right. I hate to keep horses up. I'm just like you, right? But if we turned him out with this kind of injury and he took a bad step, with the swelling in those fibers, he could have some tearing. And with tearing, he's going to be out of work a lot longer. So I'm just asking for 30 days. Yep. We're going to start there.
And but making sure to get him out a little bit so he doesn't get too stiff
right,
or anything.
Hand walk him. I want you to hand walk him twice a day. Get him out. Let him get some fresh air, some grass. So that's very important. Now, I'm also sending you home with some medication, mm-hmm, okay? Sending him on some systemic medication. I'm using a steroid on him, okay? And there's non-steroidals like butenbanamine,
okay,
and there's steroidals. All those drugs focus on swelling, right?
Okay.
So I'm sending you home on some medication, but I'm only going to do that swelling medication for a short period of time. For the first week, we're going to focus on trying to get that swelling out. I'm also going to send you home on a topical cream, and mm-hmm, this cream is very focused on this area. It's a cream called Surpass. It's been out a few years, but it's very effective to take down soft tissue swelling.
And I want to let everybody know that he's not swollen to where you can see it. It's like internal, like I would never see it.
Yeah.
So it's not like his whole leg is swollen, but inside it is important to get the internal swelling that we can't really see.
Right, yeah. You can only see it with an ultrasound,
yeah,
right? I mean, I couldn't see it myself until I put an ultrasound on, and then I could see the swelling. So we're going to focus on, so why is that so important? Swelling in the suspensory slows the healing of the suspensory.
Okay.
And so we want to speed the healing, so we want to get that swelling out. And, you know, there's other things that we could do that we may talk about next month, but right now we're going to take a conservative approach and we're going to rest the horse and we're going to try to get that swelling down.
Okay, so we have two of those, the medications that I have to be diligently giving to Quick.
Yep.
And keeping him in the stall.
Right.
But I'm not wrapping him or anything, just kind of letting it do its thing.
Just letting him rest, yeah.
Had it been worse, if somebody were to have a tear in their horse's suspensory, what
right,
then would
right, we
recommend?
See that a lot. And when I see a hole in the suspensory, suspensories heal very slowly. And the reason they heal slowly is they have poor blood supply. So what we can do is we can harvest the blood from your horse, centrifuge it, and remove the platelets. It's called platelet-rich plasma. We take the plasma and we concentrate the platelets. And then with an ultrasound, we take a little needle and we inject the platelets into the hole.
That's
You're
so
like,
interesting.
Why do you do that? We're taking the horse's own healing properties, put him right in the spot, so it speed the healing. You'll cut your healing time down significantly.
Okay.
And we'll follow that up sometimes with laser therapy or with shockwave therapy. So there's other things we can do. I'm hoping that we don't have to go there with Quick.
Right.
But that's kind of some other options.
So that's what we'll find out in 30 days.
Exactly. We're going to give him 30 days to start. Yep.
Okay. And after the 30 days, it's important that we don't just get right back to it.
No. I'm hoping that he has a good exam in 30 days. The ultrasound's good. He palpates good. Then we're going to start very slowly. We're going to tack walk him for a few days, and
okay,
then we'll start trotting some straight lines. And we'll do that over about a 10-day period. Then we'll start trotting some circles. So I'm going to put you on a rehab program
okay,
the next 30 days. My goal is that Quick will be back doing his job in the next 2 months. 30 days of rest, 30 days of rehab. And, you know, we'll just have to play it by ear. We're going to have to watch it close and see how he responds.
So for someone like me, for anybody with a horse, what are some things that they can do to prevent something like this happening? I know, you know, it's hard. That's hard to do because of what we're putting them through. But
right,
do you have any advice for?
Well, I mentioned it earlier. I mean, after your horse performs and works, I love ice. 20 minutes of ice after work is really, really good. A lot of folks use poultice. Poultice in the legs after a hard work, very, very good. Supporting the leg while you work, very, very important. stretching your horse out prior to work, okay, making sure he loosens up good before you work him. There's lots of little things, just like you and I, right? We go to the gym. If we just jump right in there and start pounding it,
yeah,
we're going to hurt ourselves.
Yeah.
If we stretch and loosen up, do our exercises, loosen up again, less likely for injury. Horses exactly the same way.
And does age have a lot to do with this? Have we seen it more in older horses?
Well, yeah, we do. I hate to say it, but the older the horse gets, the more stress on their joints and the more we start seeing these things. So there's all kinds of things we can do for joint maintenance to protect the joints. And we're going to talk about doing maybe injecting Quick's hocks or getting
right.
him on some medication for his hocks. And I'm going to address that after we get the suspensory. Because I know if I treat his hocks, he's going to feel better, and you're going to want to ride him too quick, right? So I don't want you to overdo
you
it.
You know me too well.
Yeah,
you
yeah.
know how
so
anxious
I'm going to
I
take
am.
It a step at a time because I don't want you to mess this suspensory up.
No, and I don't either, and that's I'm trying to be responsible here.
Yeah.
We have a little clip of Quick leaving the Tennessee Equine Hospital. He had an enjoyable stay, I think he was. I was hoping he'd be happier to see me, but he seemed pretty content in his stall there. And this facility, I'm telling you what, it was top notch, and everyone there was so kind and really, yeah. See, even my vet even knows his name and say goodbye to him. Really, just a nice facility, and made such a difference to me knowing that my horse was taken care of. While he was injured and is going to be followed up with correctly. You know, having a good vet clinic that has all the resources available to make sure that he's diagnosed.
Right.
And
yeah, there are great hospitals all over this country. We've got a lot of neat callers call in today.
Yeah.
I encourage you to get a relationship with your vet. We're on your team, and the veterinarians want to help you.
Well, I appreciate your help. I appreciate you being our resident vet here on Horse Talk Live.
Thank you.
And encourage our viewers to call in with any questions that you have during the show whenever Dr. Monty's on, or send us an email at horses@rfdtv.com. I'll pass those questions along to him and answer them on the show and make sure that everybody is getting their horses sound, keeping them sound, and enjoying their time, because that's what it's all about. We're here to enjoy our horses. And we appreciate you joining in for us with us for an episode of Horse Talk Live. We'll see you next time on Rural TV, television for a growing world.